In a calm but chilly autumn night in 1972, a deadly plague surrounded the quiet town of Cloverdale. Spreading rapidly, it was difficult for many to seek refuge for the healthcare each so needed for this deadly illness. As it was this night, two sisters sadly lost their parents. Alice and Elizabeth Bricker were young, but yet old enough to care for themselves. Neither were taken to a foster home. Allie and Beth grew up parentless, but they managed. Dr. Reese and Lyra Fonte, both very well-known entrepreneurs in Cloverdale, made sure the girls' needs were taken care of. Luckily, no one disputed how these two girls should be cared for. But the Fontes made daily walkabouts to the girls' house as a way to check on them, without neither knowing they were actually being cared for by an adult. Charles Beaufort, who owned the factory that made the town's main analytical engines and gears. One of Beaufort's newly engineered circuits was stolen and traced to Elizabeth. In secret, Elizabeth was indeed part of the stolen heist, but never will admit it. For it was indeed the two sisters who were inventing the most amazing invention of all. They had two friends, Artem and Joseph, that were doing all the inside heists from the factory. On this night, Elizabeth was to meet Artem for this last special part, to complete the project she and her sister Alice have been working on for over 5.5 years. Luckily, Artem was late in meeting with Elizabeth.
Everything is all clean and packed away. I'm heading home now, if that's okay.
Very good. Night, Beth.
Good night, Mrs. Fonte.
Hey. Bricker. You got something of mine. Give it to me and nothing will happen to you. Someone told Harold they saw you with our products and then selling them to the highest bidder.
Oh, come on, Charlie. I don't know what you're talking about.
Hand over the damn chip and we won't hurt you.
Hey, I saw you taking money from that dude with a scar on his lip. He's been stealing our products.
Is everything all right over there, Elizabeth?
Yes. Thanks, Mrs. Fonte.
You boys better run along now. Have a good night.
Now get out of my way.
Why did you let that old lady make you stop? I know that Bricker chick stole our mechanism.
We must respect our elders, they're the backbone to our city. We'll get Bricker another day.
It's a good thing you're late. Beaufort had me cornered, but Lyra walked out the door just in time.
Yeah, I know. I saw the minute hit. I cannot take any chances. Man, you know, I need my job.
I know, but this will be it. I think Allie said this is all we need. It should power up now.
Okay, we good. Give my love to Allie.
Thank you, Artem. Hey, Allie, I got the chip. Oh, very good. I just finished the last loop of circuits in his arm. That damn Charles and Harold jumped me after work, but Lyra came out just in time and made them leave me alone. Sweet Lyra. We must give thanks to her and Doc. They've been our blessed caretakers all these years. Yeah, all those years their walkabouts to our house wasn't for no reason. Hey, will Max have a willy?
A willy on a robot?
Beth.
Slut!
So, when is Joseph coming over with the synthetic patches? Later, tonight. I hope he doesn't hang around long. You don't like him, do you? How can you kiss him with that scar on his lip? Who says we kiss? Oh, right. Sure you don't.
Do you ladies need some help with this? I'd be more than happy to help.
Nope, we got it. Bye-bye. Wait a minute. Thank you, sweetie.
After Joseph left the stolen synthetic fiber patches, the girls adjusted each piece of fiber inside Max's electro suit and placed the chip inside the circuit board on his eye. The electronic fibers began to pulsate, and it would be only a matter of a few hours for Alice to be able to transfer a number of knowledgeable inputs for Max to store in his microchip and be able to communicate and function on his own.
So, what is he going to look like? Oh, the best looking man you can imagine. Dark hair, blue eyes. Green eyes. Green? Okay. Green eyes he shall have.
The sisters worked hard, day and night, on their machine man, and the day finally came when Max was complete. The time arrived. The sisters took Max outside for the first time. Even though Max was a machine and didn't have human senses, such as smelling or touch, but he was capable of knowing and understanding different atmospheres, as well as the difference between day and night time. The sisters programmed as much info about humans, their senses, feelings, emotions, and whatever they could find possible for Max to adapt to the human world. Each day Max would add input information, which he observed from watching Joseph and Alice, and then he would react to Elizabeth with the same actions. But Max was only a machine, so he really didn't understand the full emotional feelings he was observing. Both Alice and Elizabeth saw these mimic emotions Max was doing, but found them more amusing than a problem erupting within Max. Elizabeth really didn't care if the emotions of Max weren't real from him, but only a mimic information stored in his memory files. She was having fun with her machine man. Each night, when the sisters went to bed, they shut Max down to make him aware how humans sleep at night to restore their energy for the next day. Max would stay in the chair until the next morning. One night, Max's chip wasn't shut completely off and his power was back up. He wasn't sure what to do alone on his own. He remembered Joseph getting liquid from the kitchen sink. He got the water and drank it. He didn't understand any of it. He opened his mouth, just like he studied Joseph doing, and poured the liquid inside him. A few minutes later, some electric charges were building up inside him, but he wasn't sure what that was about, so he just went back to the chair until morning time. The next morning, to the sisters' horrid surprise, they found Max completely deteriorating, and he could hardly function at all. they were able to get him to the shop and started working on him. All the months of enjoyment with Max, the sisters had hopes of creating more just like him and making a big profitable business. But to their dismay, Max began to deteriorate. His synthetic skin was rejecting the internal layers of circuitry. The sisters searched everywhere possible for answers, but the longer they took researching to learn more about circuit mechanisms, the worse Max got. It was now to the point that the sisters realized they failed and could no longer continue with Max. The sisters sadly renounced and completely shut Max down. They placed him into a secured sealed storage bin, in hope of one day in the future, someone might have the knowledge and equipment to resume him back into a more advanced machine man. But for now, Alice and Elizabeth Bricker continued their lives as normal, but always thinking of what was, and what could have been with their handsome Max, the machine man. Alice decided to continue her relationship with Joseph. Alice and Joseph incorporated their own service of analytical engines and gears for private owners, who hired them to craft outrageous builds of anything they could possibly envision. It took a few months for the girls' disappointed feelings to ease up. Elizabeth kept her job at the Fonte Bistro as bartender. Each day Elizabeth kept in good spirits, but there was still a touch of sadness and disappointment of Max. Then one night a stranger comes into the bar.
You just gonna stare at me?
You look familiar.
I don't think we've ever met. I'd remember a pretty face like yours.
I'm Elizabeth. What is your name?
William. William Maxwell. I'm on business. Looking for a guy, by the name Beaufort.
I know him.
Someone's been stealing his products, and I'm here to catch the thieves for him.
Oh, really?